iOS 18, macOS Sequoia, watchOS 11, etc. are all officially released. I hope you all got your updates out. My iOS 18 updates to my courses are in progress. I'm working on getting all that filmed, edited, uploaded. So keep an eye out for a 30% off sale coming soon. All right, let's get into September Swift News. And as always, links to everything you see will be in the Swift News GitHub repo, and the link to that repo is in the description. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. So with the release of iOS 18, macOS Sequoia, all that stuff, that means Swift 6 is now official. And this is a pretty big deal. And if you're a regular viewer of Swift News, you know I've been talking about this for the past few months, but that was to prep you for it. Now it is official. And this brings Swift 6 concurrency, which is a pretty big deal, pretty big change in the way we do things, but it is not required. It is opt-in. You don't immediately have to adopt it because adopting it's going to be a heavy workload most likely. But as I've said before, my recommendation, if it seems like a good fit for your app to migrate, because it's not for everyone, I don't recommend everyone do it, especially if you have a very old code base. However, if you think it is a good fit, I would recommend doing it sooner rather than later, because again, it changes the way you think about things. It is going to be a heavy lift. I just think the sooner the better if it's a good fit for you. And that brings me to these migration guides that I've also been sharing over the past few months. So again, if you aren't caught up, go back to the Swift News GitHub repo, look at those links. But Telemetry Deck just shared their migration guide. And the reason I find these to be so helpful, again, I'm skimming through to the part here, is they talk about the common errors that they ran into, right? Computed properties versus stored properties. And they walk through the error, the warning. Down here, reference types versus, or value types versus reference types. And here's an example of the warning. Now, of course, the warning's not gonna be exactly what you run into, but it can point you in the right direction. And like I said, I've shared a lot of these migration guides. This is yet another one that shares the common errors they ran into. It will be so helpful. In your migration to Swift 6, which again, I recommend to do sooner rather than later, if it's a good fit for your project. Another big deadline coming up, which may only apply to you if you're an indie dev, if you work for a company, they gotta handle it. But the requirements for app distribution in the European Union require you to designate your trader status. You know, there's more to it. You can click on this link to learn more about it. But essentially what we have to do as indie devs or companies is provide an address and a phone number. Now, if you're an official company, you have probably an official address and an official phone number. However, if you're an indie dev, that might be your home address and home phone number. You don't want that on the App Store. So if you want your app to continue to sell in the EU after October 16th, right? That's the deadline. That's coming up in a couple weeks. You need to provide that. And again, in previous episodes of Swift News, I've provided blog posts that show you exactly how you can set up, you know, virtual phone numbers, virtual PO boxes, all that stuff if you're an indie dev. So again, check out the GitHub repo for those links. But the reason I'm sharing this again, because I've talked about this a lot too, is the deadline is rapidly approaching. And now that iOS 18 is official, that means the typical N-1 for iOS support brings us to iOS 17. And with iOS 17 comes the observable macro, kind of SwiftUI's way of revamping, you know, state object, observed object. This is the new modern way that hopefully won't change because this has changed a lot in SwiftUI's early life. But Jesse Squires here has a gotcha that he ran into. And that is observable is not just a direct drop-in for observed object. And the thing that tripped him up with observable object, you had to write things as state object to get access to that. Well, now in the new observed way of doing things as of iOS 17, state object isn't a thing anymore. Everything is always state. And he does a great job walking through this and explaining everything, but that's the gist of it. If you are switching to observable, make sure state object is nowhere in your code base because that's not a thing in the new observable world, which again, now that iOS 18 is official, a lot of apps are only supporting back to iOS 17, so now you can adopt it. And hopefully this article will help you not get caught up by that gotcha with state object. I wanted to share this tweet by Flavio because I've been using AI a lot lately in my day job, and by and large, it has made me so much more productive. It has been so helpful, but it's not without its drawbacks. And that's what this tweet says. One thing I notice is that the more I use AI to generate my code, the less intimately familiar I get with my code base. It feels less handmade and less in my head as a whole. Sounds obvious, but a pretty big drawback. I guess balance is key. So I agree with this. And one thing that I've noticed myself doing is becoming a little lazier. So I use ChatGPT a lot to refactor. And I'll write out the nastiest if-else nested statement I can, right? Because I'm just going through the logic in my head, right? Like, if this, do that, if else this, right? Just, you know what that code looks like. It's just nasty and hard to read. but I don't care. I'm just like writing out my logic and then I copy and paste that into ChatGPT, say, write this in a more clean, concise, modern, readable way. Boom, it spits out a beautifully refactored, clean piece of code, and I just copy and paste and go with that. Now, is that good or bad? On one hand, I could think that's good because I'm still thinking through the logic and doing that. I'm just not writing it in the clean syntax, sugary way. On the other hand, I'm like, part of the fun is coming up with the clean way to write it. And that's kind of like the creativity expression, not just to show off how clever you are, but to make it more readable for other developers. That's what I always think of when I refactor things. What's the maximum readability for other people coming into this code base? So I don't know. I think that's a drawback. Like I do find myself being a little lazier and just like letting ChatGPT handle it, helping me understand obscure Xcode errors. It's amazing for that. And I learned so much from like ChatGPT, I think because I have prior knowledge, right? It's not teaching me from scratch, but a lot of times I'll ask it a question and I'm like, oh, that's a clever way they did that. But because I have a pretty good understanding of the Swift language, like it all makes sense to me. I see where they went. But that prior knowledge also helps me spot the hallucinations that inevitably occur. Because sometimes it'll spit something out and on the surface, I'm like, oh, that looks good. And I'm like, oh, wait, that doesn't work. No, what? That's completely wrong. So I think AI is great if you have that existing knowledge. It's hard to put myself back in those shoes when I was just learning and having AI available, I don't know if that would confuse me more than help me, but the reason I want to share this too is also, I want to hear your thoughts. What are the good experiences you've had with AI? What are some of the drawbacks you've noticed in your workflow, right? Aside from the obvious, like it hallucinates, it's not always correct. We all know that. But in your workflow, what have you noticed has changed? Like I said, I've noticed myself getting a little lazier and I don't know how I feel about that. Moving on, we have a new little twist in Xcode 16 with folders and groups. And this article does a great job breaking down the differences between a group and a folder. Because yes, as you see on the screen, the colors are a little different, but like what is actually different? And the short version is that groups, like looking over on the left with Xcode 15, you could drag your files around, order them precisely how you wanted. But when you did this, your project file would get affected. Anyone that's dealt with a merge conflict in a project file, you know exactly what we're talking about. Like someone could just move a file and that causes a merge conflict. Whereas folders kind of mirror what you have in Finder. So you can organize and move stuff around in Finder and it will reflect in Xcode, but you can't actually move stuff around in Xcode. Now, for those of us that have been around for a while, we have the muscle memory of being able to organize things directly in Xcode. We may hate this at first, but again, this is a cause of a lot of merge conflicts when working on a large team, just the project file. That is also not like Swift code, right? If you're not used to seeing it, it looks like a bunch of gibberish. So those can be hard to untangle sometimes. So ultimately, I think this is a good move. It's just gonna break the muscle memory for a lot of us people that have been around for a while. But I think this will solve a lot of problems on large teams. And speaking of Xcode jargon, like folders, groups, what's the difference? Stuart Lynch has a great video here for you talking about Xcode templates, projects, targets, schemes, workspaces. You may have heard these terms before. And look, I've been doing this for a decade, just straight Swift development. And I still will admit, I have like a loose understanding of how schemes work and targets and all that stuff. Like, again, I have a loose understanding just from dealing with it, but I do not claim to be an expert on that topic. So this video was great. And if you are unfamiliar with like how schemes work, targets, Stuart's always very thorough in his videos. He's got a great one here for you. Moving on to the indie dev portion of the show and continuing from last month where we announced the Revenue Cat Shipathon project, here are the winners. And to recap, Revenue Cat launched a few weeks long, a hackathon contest where, you know, top prize in three different categories was 5,000. You got digital billboards all over San Francisco. It's a really great event. And it was fun to follow along on Twitter because build in public was one of the award categories. So many people were sharing what they're building. And I'm just a sucker for that stuff. I love seeing people design and build little screens and iterate on their product. So this was an awesome event to follow along. I happened to be a judge of it as well. Now, I think there was 1,500 to 1,600 entries, so I didn't judge 1,600 apps, right? I only got a little section of those. I think it was about 25 apps that I had to look at and judge. But a great event from Revenue Cat Shipathon. If you are curious who the winners were, like here's the awards. Most likely to make money, and that was the Caro app. And I'll run through, we'll go to the other categories. There's second place, third place, but there was also the Revenue Cat Design Award. So if you want to see what got the award for best design. And then the final category was the Build in Public Award, which RudRank won with the meshing app. Again, he crushed the Build in Public. He was sharing like so much. And it was so cool to see the iteration of that, which again, I'm a sucker for. So that was a well-deserved build and public award. But as a judge, I got to see, again, about 25 of the apps, and man, there's some really good ideas, really unique designs. And I'm really happy I got to be a small part of it to judge it. But yeah, if you're an indie dev or thinking about building a project, definitely read through this blog post, check out the apps that won, and use them as inspiration. If you're tinkering with indie apps or indie projects and it's starting to make a little bit of money and you're like, man, I would love to quit my full-time job and do this full-time. Antoine Vanderlee just released a new course, From Side Project to Going Indie, basically how you can transform that project into your career. And as someone who was full-time indie from 2019 to 2024, I actually just got a full-time job a few months ago, I want to tell you that it's life-changing if you can do it. It's not easy. And again, Antoine has this course here to help you out, get you in the mindset, talk to you about marketing, you know, how to actually manage your time and focus. But, you know, we're in a pretty tough job market for iOS developers, software developers in general. And the way I look at having indie projects, whether that's an indie app, a blog, a podcast, a YouTube channel, is that it's insurance in bad times and just bonus money in good times. So I think it's kind of a no-brainer to try it if you're interested in it. Because even if your indie project isn't making enough money to replace your full-time income, if you get laid off, which unfortunately has happened to a lot of people, or if you're struggling to break into the industry, at least you have some income to like help out with that rather than zero. And then when the good times come back, because yeah, we've been in some bad times for a couple years now, but the good times will come back. And now you've built this project. Well, that's just supplemental income if you decide to go back and get a full-time job, or it becomes your full-time job. It's just the optionality and the flexibility. I just think you can't beat it. So that's my testimonial to say how great it is if you can have an indie project for yourself that makes a decent amount of money. And again, here's Antoine's course all about doing that. And you know who Antoine is. Big creator in the space. Love his stuff. I'm sure you've used plenty of his blog posts when Googling how to do stuff. And one of the things I think is most valuable in this course, scroll down here, is the conversations with other successful indie devs and hearing them talk about their business, their strategies, what they do. I think this is insanely, I mean, the whole thing is valuable, but these conversations are just gold. So I know indie dev's not for everyone. I'm not saying everyone should do it, but man, you can't argue with in the bad times, you know, you're worried about losing your job. You have somewhat of a backup plan and insurance policy. I just think that's a smart move in today's day and age with software and who knows what AI is going to do to us. It's just, I don't want to like be a fear monger, but it's an interesting time. Like there's a shift going on in our industry. So I think the more backup plans you can have, probably the better. And as a disclaimer, this isn't sponsored by Antoine. I know I sound like I'm glowing about this, but it's just because I believe so strongly in indie dev and having a side project that makes a little money for all the reasons I just spoke about. Antoine and I have interacted on Twitter for years now. He puts out amazing stuff, so wanted to help share it. But if you are building indie apps, I think it's a must to have an iOS developer website to showcase your work. So that does bring me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. All right, let's finish off the episode with some quick hitting tips here. So Natalia has hierarchical background styles in SwiftUI. Now, this is new as of iOS 17. We used to have to do, you know, color, UI color, dot secondary system background. Now you can do dot background dot secondary, which is cool. Why I wanted to share this, and I thought this was cool, kind of mind-blowing to me, didn't know about this, was you can do this with colors too. Scroll down a bit. Look, you can do background green dot tertiary, green dot secondary, and like look at the different outcomes you get. So even if you wanted to stick with Apple's built-in colors, right, you didn't want to create your own custom colors, you can have a color palette with green, green dot secondary, green dot tertiary. I don't know if there's a quaternary. Anyway, maybe there is. But anyway, this was mind-blowing to me. I thought this was awesome. Wanted to share it. And where can you use these different color greens? Boom, gotcha. GitHub contribution graph with Swift charts by Artem here. So we all know and love the GitHub chart. It's also very common in a lot of habit tracker apps. But Artem here shows you how to build this in Swift charts. And as you can see, you can use green dot primary, green dot secondary, green dot tertiary, already built in right there. And finally, I wanted to share this YouTube video by Mikola here. He's a web developer who explores various technologies for building iOS apps. I mean, we have WebStack, Flutter, React Native, and then finally, native in Swift UI. And I thought this was an interesting perspective. He goes through all of them, talks about the pros and cons, because he is a web developer, right? His natural tendency, let me use the tools I know. I know web development, let me stick with that cross-platform stuff. But he ultimately ended up on native and Swift UI. So, you know, this is all stuff we probably already know, but I thought it was interesting to hear the perspective, you know, from a web developer and how they landed on Swift UI. All right, that wraps it up for the September episode of Swift News. See you in the next one.